I understand we have a small talk for a minute or two. Photo walk, I think.
I got to bring it again. I got to see.
The other side is like, you know,
industrial innovation.
Sam? Yeah, we're ready to go now.
Mr. President, would it be okay with you if Mr. Burford resigned?
Now, you know, Bill, I don't take any questions, but and I won't answer that one. I will only say that sometime you might ask me a question about several dozen other people, not on my staff.
You mean the people who are not on your, the people who are talking about this? Is that what you're referring to?
Could be.
What do they say? Do you want it to be done?
No question.
Well, tell us something, Mr. Mayor.
They're all good.
You mean you'd like to fire someone not on your staff?
No, we're here to talk about the enterprise zone, and that's good. I've just signed the legislation and sent it up to the Hill.
And hopefully we'll get quick action.
Oh, yes, so that I can sign it for real.
We're going to move quickly on this. It looks like a good job.
You get Danny. Yes. Danny.
Part of phase two.
Although I suspect that there are microphones on the doorknob of some kind, but.
I was interrupting someone. I'm sorry to be late. I'm going to have a new rule. Please sit down. I have a new rule that anytime I have a meeting with members of the Congress, don't schedule anything for a half an hour afterward. It always seems to run over. But now, here, good afternoon and welcome to all of you. Delighted to have you here. Mm-hmm. I feel as if I'm looking into the future of America, and the future looks very good from where I stand. I'm very pleased to be able to congratulate you on your outstanding achievements. And I think that one of the special, that we owe a special thanks to the people of the Science Service for their commitment to the high standards of this award program. And also a thanks to Westinghouse for its many years of financial support, which makes this possible. And there are a few people in the room who may know that after 8 years on the General Electric Theater, it sounded strange to me to be praising Westinghouse. But we are grateful. people like you and the 13,000 other students who entered this competition will shape our destiny as a nation. Science and technology are the keys to prosperity, to learning, to higher quality of life. And I think that technology and opportunity go hand in hand. Just the other day in California, I made mention of a firm in Silicon Valley that one man started just a few years ago, and in just a few years, they had $7 million in sales, and now they have $25 million in sales. In 1986, they were estimating they have $300 million in sales. So technology and opportunity do go hand in hand. You know, there is an international national satellite that is under construction here in, and we hope to launch it by 1986, and I'm baffled completely. It's beyond my imagination. I'm told that it will be able to transmit the equivalent of the Encyclopedia Britannica every 3 seconds. And that's kind of a crowded call. We've opened the door, but we've only taken our first small steps into this technological age. And that's why I'm placing strong emphasis on support for research and development, and especially basic research in our universities. In fact, your entry into college next fall will coincide with the beginning of a significant expansion of academic research opportunities. And today is the day for you students, but let's remember too how important your teachers were and are with regard to your success. We want America to be the best, and our teachers are invaluable. They're a national resource for all of us. There is no career more honorable or important than teaching. And we've begun several new programs this year to give teachers the kind of assistance and recognition that they deserve. I'm looking forward to making the first round presidential awards for teaching excellence in science and math. But each of us here has a responsibility. You and your families and your own communities must work to demand higher standards in education. Science education is so vital to this future that we've been talking about. You have to make sure that it gets the resources that are needed to continue producing outstanding students. And I thank you now again for coming to see us, and I thank you for your personal initiative and achievement, because that's what will make America great again. It's great now, it's going to be great. But it's been a secret of America from the very beginning. So now they tell me that having finished saying that, I'm supposed to go back and stand in the aisle back there so that these photographers up here can get pictures of all of us. And that too is an improvement. I can remember when my high school class picture was taken, and they actually had a still camera to pan, but the only way they could get a group this wide was to pan across. And then you'd look in the yearbook, and there was that picture, that photograph. And if you look closely, invariably, you saw the same person on each end in the back. Someone would always duck down, run along behind the head of the camera. But I'll go back there.
Thank you. Right. Well, I know I'm just late for another one, and I have to get going for that, but I just can't resist. There must be someone among you who sometime or other said, boy, if I ever had a chance to ask him, I'd ask, and if somebody feels that way, why don't you? don't ask too scientific a question. I might not be able to handle it.
Now is, so you were just speaking about the importance of science and technology in education. What, how do you feel also about humanities in education?
About what?
Humanities.
Humanities. Oh, well, no question of that. Having been a graduate of a liberal arts college myself, I do believe in that. But I think
What made me emphasize the other is that in recent years, there has been a steady decline. Now, I don't know about your schools, but in too many schools, differing from an earlier day, things like mathematics and science became optional. And in an earlier day, there was a cross-section of courses ranging from the humanities to the others, that all of which had certain minimum requirements that you had to take them on the basis that at this particular stage of your life, you needed to be exposed to all of these various things in order to help you make up your mind which course you wanted to follow. And it's my understanding that lately there has been more and more a tendency to have them all free choice and no required courses of that kind. If you have not had mathematics by the time you're 16, there's no way that you can ever become an engineer. But let me just give you an answer as to why we're emphasizing this now. If you take a Sunday paper in a metropolitan area, whether it's Washington or Chicago or Los Angeles or wherever, the Sunday paper specifically, because that's the paper that they always put the most of the help wanted ads in, count the pages of help wanted ads in this time when 11 million people are out of work in our country. These are ads of employers begging someone to come and apply for a job. But then look at the qualifications required in most of those ads, and you'll find that in our country today there is a shortage in these fields. And it has begun when I was in high school, all the way through, you had to in order to get a diploma. Now, I was interested in the humanities and was interested in English and writing and so forth. That was what appealed to me. But I had to take mathematics all the way through geometry in high school. And when you got to college, you had to take, there were required courses. They gradually dwindled out as you picked, by that time, the major that you wanted to follow. But there were required courses to begin with still, mathematics, languages, and some science. So it has become a shortage right now. And we need, if we're going to have the technicians that we need, we're going to have to follow or emphasize this right now and have some more requirement. Right today, I think the Japanese and the West Germans are graduating several times as many as a percentage students in math and science as we are here in this land that is so based on technology. Was there one other you did? And then I know I'm going to have to run.
It seems that every time you appear in public, someone will ask you, are you going to run for president again? That's not what I'm going to ask you.
I thank
you. No one ever asks you, when are you going to decide whether you're going to Seeing as how the Democrats Democratic candidates seem to be getting all the press, and until you decide, the Republican campaign really can't start.
Well, I can tell you, I realize that there is a time coming in this coming year when I am going to have to make an announcement. Now, you know, your chance of guessing right is 50-50. I'm not, or I am. But I feel two things. First of all, we have more and more, and this is true of our opposing party with what they're doing, we have more and more lengthened the campaigning to the place that I believe it is directly proportionate to the reduction in the percentage of people who bother to vote. We've been going downhill year after year in the number of people who vote, and part of it, I think, is because it used to be that an election year was kind of a big event. Well, now it seems as if campaigning goes on forever. First of all, every 2 years the congressman running, but in the alternate years you've got state elections in many of our states, you've got local elections, and this thing of just think these people have declared already, they'll be campaigning for 2 years. But for me, to answer your question directly, if I say I won't too early, I'm a lame duck and can't get anything done. if I say I will too early, then everything I suggest is going to be viewed as political and part of an election campaign and thus discredited. And this third thing is, I think that the people themselves kind of let you know whether you should run for re-election. So I'm listening, watching, and I must say, I'm enjoying what I'm doing. I've been out on the mashed potato circuit for a lot of years talking about the things that I think ought to be done, and to have a chance to actually deal with them and try to get them done is very fulfilling. And I can tell you that public service is fulfilling if you have some things you believe in and that you want to make those things happen. I wouldn't select politics as a career just because it looks like a good job. We don't need that. Well, again, thank you all and congratulations to you all. What you achieved. I think your country is grateful to you. So now, I'll do as the little girl told me in a letter very early when I was governor. She told me all the things that I had to deal with. And she was pretty informed for about a 10-year-old that inflation and all these things that needed to be solved, and then she wound up with P.S. Now get to the Oval Office and get to work. I'll do that. Okay, thank you.